back in the day, I used to own Fitbit. I don't know how many of you guys went to that crazy. But basically what it is it's a wristband that you wear, and it tracks your steps. It was very popular. When it first came out, and I think the reason why its popularity was so big, like, it was piggybacking on this idea of walking 10,000 steps a day. So you download an app, and it keeps track of your steps. You can see it, you can monitor it. And one of the cool features of this app is you can invite your friends, and you can compete with each other. You can compete with each other to see who has the most walks, the most steps in a day or in a week. And at first, it was a lot of fun. It kept me motivated to walk more. I would park further away if I was at the mall, if I was in the grocery shopping, or I would take a stair rather than an elevator. It basically incentivizes you to walk more, just purely based on wanting to be number one, and in turn, you are simultaneously getting extra money. It's a win-win model, it's a win-win situation. What they were trying to do was they were trying to gamify exercise, and as a result, motivate people to move more, all in the name of health. Gamification is not just in video games, but it has infiltrated all facets of our life, including health. The reason gamification has become a phenomenon is because it plays on our culture of hyper-individualization. Unfortunately, Christianity has also been, in some ways, gamified. With my Fitbit, at first it was fun, but eventually, became a burden. And rather than focusing on the fact that I'm getting the exercise that I need and seeing it as something good, I began to become obsessed with trying to be number one. And I think in the same way, Christianity has created a culture of striving to be the best, striving to be worthy, striving to be good enough. Of course, there's nothing wrong with wanting to be the best. But when it's at the cost of others, that's when it becomes a serious issue. Pastor Moses last week painted a picture, a narrative of Jericho, that there's not enough for everyone. Therefore, it's okay to get the community, even if it's at the cost of others. There are structures and systems as a direct result of the false narrative of scarcity, where people are living in fear of not having enough. Debbie and I took our unique tiger, rock climbing, and we were just so excited to be sort of genuine interest in wanting to do this. So Tiger would start climbing the wall, and of course he's securing the harness in the rope, right? Nothing happened to her. But she would periodically stop and look over her shoulder. She would climb the wall, she'd stop, and she'd look back. And she does this several times. She's doing this because, she wants to first see if we're rocking her, and second, she wants us to acknowledge, good job, way to go, right? In evaluation. Where's the evaluation? But then talking to her, constantly stopping and looking back, you notice that she's getting tired. Like, your legs are getting shaky, your arms are getting shaky. And the fear would overwhelm her whole body, and she's trying to stop, and she gets stuck. Right? And we have to remind her to say, hey, stop looking back and just focus on what you're doing. Watch, face the hand face, your foot face, just focus on getting up the wall. You're wasting all your energy. Pay attention. Focus on what you're doing. I think this is what Jesus is trying to tell us. It's to focus on what we need to do. And to not be distracted by the actions or the reactions of what other people are doing around us. But but we can get all that more. If you believe this is creating God or that to pray, it's highly likely that you're going to win. Sorry. Did you think you're winning? Then you're already winning a lot. And what's worse, the living a lot is thinking that you're better because of that lie. This is a direct result of the culture and culture of living in the to think that you're better than someone else and to pray it in the name of God. This kind of lie brings systems and structures of injustice. Many in the name of God. What are we to do with this to call? If this is what it means to be ready. In verse 34, it says, when the king will say to those on his right, come, you will receive good things from my father. But you in there, right? The you that we need right there is not referring to a specific individual. It's an entire group of people. You see, they're not called to work alone. They're not called to do the work. You're not called to do the work alone. You're called to work together. We are to get ready together. We are to work together and we will be brought together. It was and is never meant to be done alone. Salvation is not an individual endeavor. Our call is not an individual call. It is a collective call. For an individual to do what God is calling us to do is a full thing. For the people of God, it is true freedom. Everything is our Lord and Savior. So what does that mean for the church? What does that mean for Calvary IC? What does that mean for a community? Any time we did this, any system of oppression, right? Any system that oppresses, or any system that attacks any of these things that we're called to do. The system that opposes the feeding of the hungry. The system that opposes offering drink to those who thirst. The system that opposes not welcoming a stranger, not holding the naked, not caring for the sick, not visiting those in prison. We as God's people need to challenge those systems of injustice. When we begin to do the things as a community, as God's people, it becomes less about us as individuals and more about those in the community. As I was preparing for the sermon, the question that I kept asking myself was, how did they not know? Because Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food? Or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it that we saw you a stranger and welcomed you? Or naked and gave you clothes? And when was it that we saw you sick or in prison and gave you food? How could they not know what they are doing? This is why salvation was never meant to be an individual salvation. This is why salvation was never meant to be gained by. Keeping score, comparing yourself with others, thinking you're better than someone else, thinking you deserve more, trying to be good, trying to be worthy. They need to be aware all the time. Do you not? This is not freedom. This is a burden. True freedom is not knowing, not keeping score, not comparing yourself to others, not trying to be better, not for worthy, not. Freedom is waiting with the absolute certainty that you, right, all of you, all of us, are loved by God. And it's because of God's love for us, we need to call out injustices in this world with boldness and conviction. The key is that we need to do it together. That we need to be ready together. That we need to work together. That's the only way. That's the only way to work. That's the only way to bring that we need right this morning. That's the only way. That these verses will actually be lived out in the kingdom of God. work together. Let's get ready to share. We care for you.